Continue our chat with singer and actress Melissa Tkautz.
I mean, you just shared that before about jumping in two-seater planes and doing gigs and having no sleep, but what would be another crazy story? Have you got the craziest story that happened to you in amongst those times?
But I don't know whether I'm allowed to talk about it. Are we allowed to talk about, like...
Can you not name names? You can talk about whatever you want.
No, it's not about naming names, but when I was... anyway, you can stop it if I can't talk about it, but I'll talk to you about it. I remember there was this woman that was looking after me, because everywhere I went, I had to have someone looking after me. I probably was about 17 and a half. And anyway, she was a rather large woman, very sort of sophisticated and did everything by the book and whatever. And she had to report back to Forrest, obviously. So anyway, she took me, I think we were in Adelaide or something, and I was opening a nightclub. Now, the thing was, I was only allowed to get up, do the gig, and leave straight away because I was underage. I wasn't even allowed to be in there. So the owners of the club came backstage before I went on and said, oh, you know, how you going? I said, oh, really good. They said, oh, so do you want an ecchi? I said, what? What's an ecchi? And they went, do you want an ecstasy pill? And I said, oh, no. What is that? And they're, oh, make you feel really good. And I said, oh, what? But is it legal? And no, look, everyone has it. Like, all those kids that are out there, they're all on it. Like, just try it. I swear to God, nothing will happen. Okay. So take this stupid tablet, right? So funny. Anyway, go on stage, do my thing. Like, I was only...
Before you went on stage?
Yeah, I was only on stage for 10 minutes. It hadn't even kicked in yet.
Right.
Get off stage. Then, you know, the woman that was looking after me said, come on, Mel, we're going to go. I said, oh, I so want to stay. So I was sort of getting a buzz feeling happening. I think I really want to stay. You know, she said, no, we've got to go. You've got to get up, you know, so early. But get back to my hotel room. She goes to her hotel room. Oh, my God. My pill hit me here. And I started tripping out. I don't know what it was. It wouldn't have been just ecstasy. I was tripping out like I cannot tell you. 17 years old, I was so naive to the point of being stupid. Mm. I'm sitting in this hotel, I'm going, oh, man, and all the walls were like coming down on me and I was like... But the funny thing is, thinking back, I just cannot believe I wasn't more freaked out than what I was, you know? But I was just sitting there going, man, what's going on? This is like heavy. I had no idea until I actually came off the thing like 6 hours later and I just went, oh my God,
yeah.
Mel, that's what ecstasy is, you know, kind of thing.
Pretty crazy.
Isn't that mad? Mm. So yeah, that was my first experience of drugs.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Crazy.
Yes. Now, looking back, you know, on times that you've had now, I mean, I like to ask people about advice I'd have for other people. And I'm sure there'd be a lot of people out there that, A, would remember you from those shows and have watched your career and stuff. What advice would you have for, say, a young girl, maybe not popping a pill in a club, but in career-wise?
That wasn't my fault. Career-wise, okay, look, it's a very difficult industry, especially in Australia. I mean, the thing is, there's not a lot of work here, and there's... every second person wanting to be in the entertainment industry. So I think things that I would have done differently is I would have got a degree. I would have like stayed on. When I should have been at year 11 and 12, I was actually on East Street. So that was a bit difficult, but I would have got a degree just so you've got something to fall back on, because you don't want to be a person who is just chasing for your next role and are living off nothing. You know what I mean? Because it's really hard. And even when you do make it, it doesn't mean you're going to be at that position forever. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So there's always going to be ups and downs. And I think if you really, really want it bad enough, go to LA, go overseas. I was ready to go. I was so ready to go. And we lost our father to cancer and I couldn't leave my mum. Mm. So, I mean, I wish that that's something that I would have wanted to do, because if you're going for auditions and stuff like that, why not do it over there? There's so much more work over there than what there is here. So if you really want to take it seriously, then do it. I mean, I'm not, not everyone goes over there and is successful.
No, you have a crack.
You have a crack. I know people that have gone over there with, you know, saved up 20 grand, have come home with absolutely nothing and still are in Australia doing absolutely nothing. So not every single person's going to make it, but it's worth a try.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think, you know.
And I love talking to people about their dreams and stuff, and I'm sure that part of what has happened to you in your past has been a part of a dream. What would be, what would be the ultimate, if you could live it now? Like, do you have things now you want to do? Is there things you want to accomplish?
Look, yeah, everyone's got a dream. I mean, I wish I was in the States doing films. I mean, that's what I really do wish, and it's just sad that you can't do that in your own country where you grew up. You know, there's just not enough films happening, and if there are films happening, they've got their favorites. They're not going to go and pick an ex soapy person to, you know. And unfortunately, because of what I've done, I've got a lot of labels attached to my name, and I've done soap after soap after soap. People think that I can't do anything else, and they think that I can just play the girl next door and all that sort of thing, you know. So it does get hard, because you do get sort of stereotyped as being a specific kind of person. This is even before they've met you. And, you know, it makes it very hard. It does make it very hard to go for a serious film role and for them to take you seriously.
Now, we're in North Sydney now and stuff, in your apartment. Like, do you get recognised a lot around town? Do you find that? Is that a weird thing for you? Because you're very, I mean, people would, wouldn't they? You look still the same as when you're on East Street.
Oh, do I? Isn't his sweetheart?
Oh. You can tell it's you.
Look, I do sometimes, and then
weird?
Sometimes. Oh, it's not weird. It's like, it's just.
What if you're in the shops and you're like in a laneway or whatever, an aisle, and you're like, oh my God, this, you can just see people going, there's that girl from.
Yeah, I don't know. I just, you block it out. It's really funny. Like, I'm never rude to anybody, but because you're not, when I'm out and I'm alone, I just block everything out. I really do. I've just learnt to do that, I guess.
I can imagine. And what's happening with your music now? What's going on?
I'm about to go back into the recording studio next week, actually. So I'm doing, I'm going to be doing a song with a DJ who's been around for a long time. And yeah, it's a cover, so I'm going to be doing that, but I can't tell you anymore. Oh. And hopefully we'll do an album. So yeah, but no, it's all good. Got a couple of gigs coming up, and
good for you. Well, it's fun to catch up with you again. We've known each other for a little bit now, from the Goldie to here.
Yeah,
nice to chat with you in your little apartment in North Sydney. Beautiful view.
It is a beautiful view. Thank you.
See you, babe.
Bye.
And you're working your way from the ground on down, on down. Your way from the ground on down, on down.